I will. Okay, so you are sitting here, and I'm supposed to go there.
No, you can sit wherever you want. I don't care.
I can sit wherever I want, but you need it.
I can stand up and move if you want.
Yeah, okay, so what do you want me to do?
You just have to get through that gate somewhere. I don't know if the roof part is the roof.
Yeah, this is just. Good day from everywhere in the world, where you're watching this game. It's day one, game three at the World Games, live here from Birmingham in Alabama in the US. It's the game between Switzerland and Team Thailand. We are happy to welcome to this game myself, Joachim, and with me, John Lillelund. John, it's the first game for Switzerland for a while. They haven't done didn't have to do the World Championships qualification. So Thailand is just off a qualification tournament. Will that have any impact for this game?
I think we will see a quite tagged Swiss team, and the question is more, the Thai team played already the Asian qualifications and they had a quite good game. So the question is more, what kind of tactic have they chosen, both teams?
On paper it's clear, top four team, top four nation versus one of the best Asian Oceania teams. What do you expect, a tight game, or will it be a kind of easy win for Team Switzerland?
Well, one would expect that Team Switzerland is going to take control of the game and take control position of the ball. And then it's more a question of what kind of game picture they are looking. They will be having tough games in the coming 4-5 days. So for them, most important is to get a win.
And it's a bit a different format. There's only 12 field players, 2 goalkeepers. Every team was able to choose. And the games go 3x15. This is it's a new format IFF have been testing. And is there already any results on this format? Any feedback?
Well, there is a lot of discussion going on about whether the format is good or bad. But one of the ideas from the start was to try to see whether it would help to close the gap between the different teams. At the moment, that is still to be seen. And this is one of the tournaments where it's tested.
Great news. We now are looking forward to this game. Soon the starting lines being announced. Switzerland will be playing from your left to your right, and Team Thailand in blue from the right to the left. Switzerland for this game is the home team. And the referees from Sweden, Thomas Andersson and Rickard Wiesman, 2 very experienced refs. Here we go with the starting 6, goalkeeper Josa Fong. And Afishet playing in the defense. And Prakasit is his partner in defense. Number 11, this is Alexander Rinefalk. 39 as a forward, Yerayut, and 19, Pavatidit. He's also the captain for Team Thailand.
And now the starters for Switzerland. At goalkeeper, number 67, Christoph Rey.
In Switzerland, starting in the net is Christoph Reich, Niels Konrad with the number 4 in defense, supported by Jan Burki, 71. In the center, Michael Schies. Number 50 on the left wing, Patrick Mendelein and Manuel Maurer. Is the 5th player on the court. We are really looking forward to this game. As we said, has been a while. Switzerland has been playing their last international game. And of course, they have been mainly training and preparing for their home world championship end of this year in Switzerland. But now it's all about this game here at the World Games in Birmingham. And ball possession for Team Switzerland. Jan Burki starting the setup. Michael Schies. Niels Konrad pushing forward, and already the first goal, Manuel Maurer. Way too easy.
Quite easy. Thailand chose a very quite passive 2-1-2 formation, and when Switzerland moved the ball downwards, there was an easy pass to pass through the diagonal, pass through the whole field, and they were totally open to score. Not so maybe the thing Thailand would have hoped to start with.
Yeah, I was just about to say the other way. And Switzerland, the way they hope to start the tournament. 23 seconds and we already have the first goal. Thailand just tried to reply, both teams now with the second lines on the court. For Switzerland, a very experienced team, or line on the court, except Seiler, number 40. He is pretty new. But yeah, Thailand once more very much in the defense, dragging themselves back in their own half and trying to defend. It's also interesting to see how the different teams will use the 12 players. So Switzerland at the moment has opted to use two full lines, so only playing 10 field players. Thailand rather look like they're going to use all 12. Is there a more or, let's say, a better or a less good approach in your perspective or from your perspective?
Well, I think that it's easier to play with two lines, so that the lines will have the possibility of agreeing things and not having players changing. Then one option would be that you would play two lines at the whole game and then just substitute one player from each line to rotate the players, because it's a long tournament, 5 games in 5 days. For Thailand, probably more also to get all players a good feel of the tournament, because this is a very difficult match for them.
Yes, and for once the difficulties well solved in defense. Counter attack with Simon. Got stopped. Irregular. Now free hit for Thailand. Kind of first time they have a chance to set up in the Swiss half. Ball loss, Seiler, shot goal. Yeah, probably from that free hit, probably wasn't taken that well from Thailand. Gave the Swiss the opportunity.
Yeah, and also the fact that the Thai are now very eager to play the ball forward when they get possession of it. And they have already lost 4 turnovers. So they've 4 times been able to open the game and 4 times lost the ball. And there is already, so to say, 2 goals scored. So most likely it will be a very, very long game for them if they can't get more control of the ball and maybe also ease a little bit down. The Swiss are not forechecking too hard. So it would be easier. They are playing 3-on-1 player in their own zone. And again, it's too risky passing to the middle.
Yeah, so far the Swiss clearly with the superior skills, a little bit as expected. But yeah, as you mentioned, it's kind of important for Team Thailand, if they have the ball, like now, Switzerland not pressing, to have ball possession, so that not only have to defend. Seems like they have been hearing you.
Yeah.
Now Jan Bürki forward as a defender up front. Nasty push in the back. Called by the refs. All good.
Yeah. The problem for the Thai team is when they play this quite passive defensive formation, is that by one pass and one player losing a player in the, on the backside, then they will be able to play through the whole tie formation. And that will open up, as the two goals have shown, that would open up the situation clearly.
Again, Swiss moving the ball pretty well. Graf, Breyer, nicely blocked. Next wave rolling on the goal from Thailand. Once more, the ball through the box. Patrick Mendelin with a shot, wasn't successful. Good save by the goalie, which will go to his stats, of course. And now the captain, Pavatidit. But Niels Konrad is a big guy, tall guy, pretty difficult to get around him. And Michael Schies bringing the ball back into the game for Switzerland. Some quick ball passing from Switzerland.
The Thai would need to decide whether they are defending in a too big area, because they can't control the Swiss attacks. So it would be easier for them if they would drop back a little bit more and prevent the Swiss from passing inside the box.
And they need to be a bit faster at the moment. The passing skills are just spot on from the Swiss team.
But after a little bit of a shaky start, let's say the last 2 minutes, the Thai have had at least come better into the game and are clearly knowing the situation, what's happening, and a little bit more controlled the defense, playing man against man on the sides of the field.
Yes, they definitely have settled in, adapted way better to the speed. And within the floorball community over years, there has been discussion, the differences from, let's say, from European, African, Asian, Oceanian, and of course American floorball, that there are obviously differences. And I think particularly the speed is obviously a huge difference from the top league in Europe comparing to other continents. How can you train that speed in those countries which are basically can't experience that, or how do you deal and cope with that?
Well, the big problem, of course, becomes the fact that you can't really practice a thing which doesn't exist. So the big question is that the speed, the understanding speed in some of the developing floorball countries is still that you run a lot. But in principle, the game speed comes from how fast you can move the ball, regardless if you run or you pass. And the ball moves faster passing than by running. So it's the combination of passing, the speed of passing, and at the same time the placement and the movement of the players.
So basically, it's also really important for this team to have the opportunities to face the European teams.
Yes, this is the way here and in the World Championship. This is the way where the teams can actually understand what the differences is and where they, so to say, are after.
And within the developing countries, there are again differences. Some teams like Thailand, they have a fair bit of players who live in Sweden, so they have at least even the chance to watch these faster games. In other countries, let's pick USA or Canada. If they live in Canada or US, they're really struggling to see that higher pace floorball life.
Yes, and of course their expectation of what the game speed is what the highest level of game speed is in the country. Now we have actually seen two quite good attacks of Thai consecutively.
Again, a breakaway. Tobias Heller bringing the ball. Sile waiting in front of the net. Didn't achieve. Paolo Riedi was able to recover the ball. Looking for good opportunities. Sile Heller. Too much time for him. At the moment, fair bit of pressure from the Swiss line. Most of them also playing in the club together in Switzerland for Grasshopper Zurich. From your experience, do you believe, like, if you have players which already used to play in the same club or even in the same line, is that any beneficial advantage in a national team?
Yes, of course, because you know what the player is going, and if you think about, like, you have Galante Karlström Enström,
some famous peers.
Yeah, well, I was thinking of Johansson, Salo and Salin in the Finnish line, who plays together always, so of course, because you know exactly what they're doing, where they're moving, where you're supposed to pass. And then of course also, but then sometimes it's also good to try to see what kind of combinations can be used, depend on how the opponent is playing. But if you know what your linesmen are doing, it will probably be much easier.
Yeah, it helps. Less surprises. Usually teams and coaches don't like too many surprises on the court. Let's see if Switzerland can lay a surprise with this free hit. There's a variation. Probably didn't work out as planned. There was no shot on goal, so well defended by Thailand. Switzerland was able to recover that ball. Now Jan Bürki. Nice shot off the post from Niels Konrad. Converted that shot from, I think it was Mendelin who took the shot from the side. Yeah, at the right spot.
A little bit of bad luck as well in for the Thais. But here is the problem, that when they allow the playing through the box and diagonal pass from one side to the other, it opens up and they don't yet have, so to say, the experience of where the players needs to do and what needs to happen when that pass goes through.
But we already can see during this game or in this first period, they are improving, they're gaining more and more, of course, of this very important experience which you have mentioned. The rate from Switzerland scoring has massively slowed down, which obviously is a clear sign that Thailand found their way into the game. Not a free hit for Thailand. Also no shot on goals, maybe now.
That was a very nice move.
Yes. And Christoph Reich in the Swiss net, almost with his first save. Good recovery again, one against one. Not precise enough. Paul already picks up the ball. Breyer, quick ball moving again. Once more, Paul already. Luca Graf.
Switzerland has now closed the midsection of the field, so it's totally impossible for the Thais. They are banging their heads against a brick. In the middle, every time they try to go up along the boards, they are capable of doing that. But in the middle, when they try to do diagonal passes, usually they lose them, and there are three Swiss players defending always.
Exactly, and then obviously Switzerland is taking then a quick breakaway, or from a Thai perspective, if they manage Mendelin with another shot, if they manage to go along the boards outside, then they can't set a shot too far away from goals. Again, ball possession for the Thai team. Line Falk. Now with the pass. Once more, the three Swiss able to pick up the ball. Now a breakaway chance for the captain. Pavatidit wasn't able to take advantage out of this. But basically this would be the chances, at the moment the only chances where they would have to have a breakaway to bring a shot on goal.
And when they get the breakaway, somebody would need to go to the goal. Now everybody is running on the same level as the ball, which then makes it difficult to pass and easier for the Swiss to defend.
So let's see how the Thai team will improve also the attacking performance. There's already some big improvements in the defense. Ready to Graf. And for once, high pressure from the Swiss team. A nice passing. Liam couldn't convert that chance. Now he could have probably taken a bit more time for the free hit as the rest of his line was subbing.
Now there is a chance, 3-2.
But with the experience from Nils Konrad, well, say from a Swiss perspective. But it's good to see Thailand finally is improving and getting their chances or the breakaway. So I'm pretty sure it won't be too long till they will have the chance to take a shot on goals. But now Switzerland again. Nils Konrad, Maurer, Brücki. Mendelin can keep that ball. Quick passing in the back line between Brücki and Konrad. And one more. And Patrick Mendelin again from a deflection of the goalkeeper. He didn't get enough support, the goalie.
No, and the problem for now, when the Swiss are attacking with, in principle, with three players below, so to say, and the Thai are defending with two players, it actually means that they have a disadvantage every time if the ball can be played through that triangle. So maybe against this formation the Swiss are using, it would be easier to play 1-2-2. So one top forward, two wing forwards, and then the two defenders. It would be clearer who is taking whom.
So basically with the idea to kind of man up on a distance to have equalizing the numbers.
Yeah. And then the defender on the ball carrying side would take, so to say, closer, and the other defender could take the player in the middle. Because now the idea is the Swiss are able to play in front of the goal easily just by one pass.
Yep. Here again. Breyer. Heller with a shot, well recovered, and the next shot. Yasafong in the net for Thailand, definitely warming up. A few saves now. Yeah, this is just another example of the differences of experiences. Just a proper bump.
Yeah, quite clean. Not again. Thailands are defending like zones where there are no Swiss players.
Yeah. It's 1 minute to go in this last period and...
First period.
Sorry, yeah. First period, that's correct. And this also will be then the chance for Thailand to go through the structure, defense structure. Let's see if they will align a few things. From a Swiss perspective, probably going as planned? Or would you change much?
No, not really. The question is more like this is probably for them a very good way of playing. They don't have to use that much strength, but also they can get the feel of the field of play and also finding lines and solutions for playing. Really well played. Excellent save.
Probably the only question is for whom you bring in, Jan Zaug and Bischofsberger.
Yeah.
What they have to discuss, maybe from a Swiss perspective.
Yeah, this of course also then gives the Swiss the possibility in advance of the other two games to see which players could be playing with each other.
Definitely, it was a very entertaining first period. Switzerland is leading 4-0. There is a 10 minutes intermission and we will be soon back for you. Welcome back to the second period in the third game of today's day between Switzerland and Thailand. We had a very entertaining first period with four goals for Team Switzerland. And we've seen a Thai team improving massive bits every minute. As discussed, there are a few changes in for the Swiss team. Looks like Jan Buki and Manuel Maro get a rest. And Jan Zaug and Bischofsberger back on the court.
This will probably not make it easier for the Thai.
No, probably not. Two very experienced players. And probably within the Swiss team, with Jan Zaug, one of the most skillful players from a technical perspective. Extremely capable of doing almost anything with the ball and stick. Here is Jan Zaug, first touch in the game. Will be also interesting to see if Team Thailand, if they have adjusted a little bit on their tactics. It's probably more in the defense structure than in the attacking structure, where from our perspective we could think of adjusting a few things.
Yeah, it would help them, of course, if they would try to find a little bit better way of opening their own game and getting possession of the ball in a controlled way in this Swiss defensive zone. At least now it looks better than it did in the first period. A little bit more controlled, a little bit more time spent on looking where to go.
Maybe also a little bit more relaxed and calm, the nerves calmed down after their very first appearance at the World Games. This is only the second time floorball is part of the World Games in the official competition. I think in 97 in Lahti or so, it was just a demonstration sport.
Yeah, just with four teams, so Finland, Sweden, Latvia and Switzerland took part.
And normally 4 years apart, but with the pandemic it is now 5 years, 2017. The tournament was in Wroclaw. Then with six teams, now with eight teams. So is there every time there's two more teams in floorball?
Well, usually there are eight teams for floorball. The big question is, of course, that if we are capable of proving that the sport brings added value to the World Games and to the 35 other sports on the program, and also that if women could be part of the competition in Chengdu in 2025, because this is still, for our sport, this is the place where a lot of sport people, in a lot of the countries, it's the National Olympic Committees who are responsible for the delegations. They will come and watch. We had today, for example, CBC Sports over here, looking at the sport, feeling what it looks like, and they felt that it was a really, really interesting sport. And at the same time, that's one way to give the exposure of the sport internationally and also then helping the sport to grow.
And talking about to see, for many it's new. This is just an example of how Switzerland is passing the ball around, how fast, how entertaining this sport can be. And of course also then with a spectacular save by the Thai goalkeeper.
Good breakaway. Good shot, good save. Second save.
Third save. Now suddenly he got busy. Christoph Reich in his very first international game for Switzerland. On the other side, then another save for Jörg Stefan.
And this just proves how fast you can go from one end to the other in an organized attack in 3 to 4 seconds.
This is why also the floorballers like to call it the fastest sport in the world. I personally usually add at least definitely the fastest in stop and go.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good to see how they picked it up, lean against the opponent's body. So Thailand definitely on an improving way.
Yeah. Maybe also a little bit dusted off the first like experience and in the first period, and now I'm more confident to play and notice that it's not that magical or difficult.
Yes, to play one of the top four nations, particularly for the team from Asia, Oceania, it's not very often that they get the chance to play against the top teams from Europe.
Well, the tournament started very interesting with Latvia tying 6-6 against Sweden.
Great save. Yes, so talking about improving countries to catch up, let's say, or to minimize the gap between the top four nations and the next countries. Did Latvia just do better work over this summer than the Swedish team, or what are your thoughts about this?
Well, I would say that first of all, Latvia played really, really wisely. They defended very, very carefully, like deep in.
Oh, another shot. Another save.
And maybe there the difference to the Thai team now at the moment is that they really executed on their breakaways. They had a clear pattern, they had a clear idea how they play. One player going deep, playing wide, playing back to the player going deep. And from there, from in principle the same place, they scored, was it 4 or 5 goals? So clearly a very well thought out tactics by the coaches.
And this is obviously a learning curve for, let's say, all the nations which are not in the top 8, top 10.
Yeah.
And as we can see, it is possible to add new things within a very short time, as we see here with Team Thailand. Oh, now this is the chance for the first goal, and it is here! The captain himself, Pavataidit, scores the first goal for Thailand at the World Games.
And here maybe the same, little bit of the same thing. The Swiss defense forgets the player behind their back, and with one pass he's free and executed beautifully.
Well spotted by the ball carrying Thai player. And here we go, first goal on the scoreboard for Team Thailand. Let's see if their excitement will now get even bigger, if they can confirm their progress. High stick called by the referees.
An injured player, Thai injured player, an ankle injury.
Let's hope he will be back soon. At the moment, Switzerland driving the next attack. Niels Konrad, Bischof Berger. Another shot from the distance. That was already part of the game plan from the Swiss team at the last international event in Helsinki. They got a fair bit of criticism after that tournament that they were not active enough in front of goals, not driving the ball on the goal. From your perspective today, did they kind of do the homework?
Yeah, they bring pressure to the in front of the goal, and they already scored at least 2 goals, so that there has been a deflection or on a rebound from the goalie, and they have a guy over there. And always when they get the ball into the side, they play it to the side. There is the other player from the other side goes into the goal and creates a mayhem.
Yeah, it will be interesting to see. And then Switzerland in the group stages will face Sweden, and Thailand obviously also has to face Sweden and Latvia. These are the 4 teams of this group. Yeah. Whereas on the other group we have Canada, USA, Finland and Czech Republic. And it's only Czech Republic and USA who haven't played yet. So that will be game number four and the last game of today for this opening day at the World Games. Started yesterday with the opening ceremony, and a fair bit of the teams also joined that. Some player reactions said it was a very interesting experience, as it isn't too often floorball is joining multi-sport events.
No, it probably is a special thing to be coming, marching in as a part of your nation and not just your floorball team. So at least the Thai team was there in full at the opening ceremony.
Another shot. She is Conrad, quick passing again, Mandeline. Gonna break away. Superior passing, but couldn't finalize it or finish it off with a shot.
Much better reaction from the Thai defense now against the formational changes the Swiss players are doing by running in and out from the formation.
Homework done in the period break. They stopped Switzerland from scoring another goal, so Switzerland is still sticking to the first four goals from the first period. Hello, Breyer. And the captain, Luca Graf. He also just came back from Sweden, back to Switzerland after his excursion to an SSL team in Sweden. Three against one. Where's the support? It's coming, but still losing the ball. Hello. Switzerland controlling the ball pretty well at the moment. Waiting for the opportunity to take a clean shot. Almost. And again, Luca Graf winning the ball back for the Swiss team. Line change. Would it also be a possibility for Team Thailand sometimes maybe to keep the ball a little bit longer and not every single time to go for a breakaway? Talking about this, we have the fifth goal for Switzerland. Executed by Bischofberger and Mandeline.
Yeah, again. It's the reaction time which is the difference. One player goes after the ball, doesn't understand that he leaves his own player behind his back, and then they are totally free to pass and score the goal from a totally empty position. And as you said, in order to get more control of the game, actually Thailand would need to get the Swiss to start be a little bit more active in their forechecking, and then also giving them the possibilities to choose where to play. Now when they play quickly, it's more a question of a 50-50 situation, whether it goes through or not.
Yes, making clear calls if it's a good opportunity for a quick breakaway or not. This is part of the learning curve. We mentioned that already a few times, but it's really great to see the learning curve from Thailand playing in blue. Again, quick ball win, Siler, hello. Yotsafong in the net for Thailand is working on his possible award for best player of the match.
Yep.
He has fair good saves. Maybe to get back to the World Games, we mentioned a little bit, it's in one way important for floorball to kind of showcase the sport and to see from a player perspective, do you know if players are also going and watch other sports and how is this interaction with different counties, different sports? How can we imagine about that?
Well, at least based in what we heard in Wroclaw, there was a lot of on the free time they had, they went to watch other sports, maybe from their own country or sports they'd never heard or seen about.
According my knowledge now here, for example, the Swiss fistball national team is here, male and female, supporting the Swiss team. It's probably exactly what you meant.
Yeah, and it gives a possibility then to see your countrymen and women in different sports and also then to go and watch. For example, I think a lot of people in Wroclaw went to watch sumo.
Which you don't see every day.
Which you don't see every day.
Again, Thai team with ball possession. Rune Falk lost it. Now the quick breakaway, Jan Sauk. Mandoline. Again, very quick passing. And it just goes too fast. Very well played by the Swiss team. The back triangle.
Yes. So if we would have a statistics to show of the big difference between the two countries is A, the passing speed of the Swiss team compared to the Thais, and then the fact that the number of unforced error Thailand makes because they try to play too quick for the sum of their skills and the opponent's capability of defending. That is probably the big difference in the game.
Yes, sometimes from the outside it looks so easy, but to be precise, it's very hard and it needs a lot of training experience. Here we go again. This is exactly the precision we've been talking about. Liam with a good chance. Free hit Thailand. Breyer gaining the ball. Graf Heller. Switzerland again trying to set up their game from a strong back line. Siler. Some good movement, ball movement, and players moving without the ball in the Swiss team, but Thailand picking it up, covering much better.
And now they've drawn their defense back a little bit and are defending from inside the box out. So it's more difficult for the Swiss to actually get the passes in front of the goal. They can still play the ball around. And as we saw, the sixth goal, which was a clear example of that. But
Thailand again. Push in the back.
But the problem also here is quite often that the player receiving the ball was facing his own goal, and then it's very difficult. Oh, beautiful goal!
Second goal for Team Thailand.
Now they have forgotten the goal scorer totally free.
If I'm right, I was efficient.
Yep.
Number 79. Good combination over 2-3 positions. Put away nicely into the net. There will be some very happy individual players in the Thai team tonight. Yes. After scoring against Switzerland. That doesn't happen too often.
No, that doesn't happen too often. And of course, also, you must really give an applaud to the Thai team that they are keeping going and trying to build the attacks, despite the fact that they have a disadvantage in the game speed.
If you're just looking at the result of this period.
Yeah.
90 seconds before the end, 2-2.
Yep, very good.
And this probably from the learning curve or developing perspective is probably also things you have to take as like see and being proud about and building on that the next steps.
Yeah, and it's easy now to go back and say, okay, look, this is what happens. These are the three or four things we would need to work on more in order to be able to get better.
Refs happy with how the Swiss team defended. Toby Heller, it was. Ooh. Another save.
Yeah, that was an important save for the goalkeeper. I know personally how it feels when you try to throw the ball through to the free player and then
basically serve it to the opponent
in front of the goal. We should probably not draw any conclusion about Sagan and the difference when they came in, but
yeah. But we're almost to conclude this period and not a big save, quick reflex. Second period, 2-2. I would say, from a result perspective, a great result for Team Thailand.
Very good, yeah.
And obviously, this second period, even more entertaining, goes on both sides.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, at the moment you can't see, but the goalie from Team Thailand, excuse me, has cramp in his thigh. And yes, he has been very busy in saving shots.
Yeah. And quite effectively so. If
we are definitely looking forward for this third period between Switzerland and Thailand. 6-2 after 30 minutes. Welcome back to the third period between Switzerland and Thailand. It's interesting, we just had the chance to talk to the both captains. Thai captain talking just about patience in defense, being patient, doing the right things. From a Swiss perspective, they mentioned particular, they physically really ready, they fast, they quick. For both teams, first time they met each other. If you hear these two comments, what are your thoughts about this?
Well, I would definitely agree with the Thai captain and his analysis of the situation. And also, I think that Switzerland gets exactly what they want from this game with the capability of testing speed and how to play in this here at the World Games in this venue.
As it won't get easier for both teams, Latvia and Sweden are waiting for both of them. Thailand with a very good start in that third period.
Yeah, and the result of this game can be quite important if it goes to a goal comparing goal differences.
Yeah. Manuel Mara with a chance.
A bit of a risk.
This also means now for Switzerland, it's Nils Konrad and Michael Schies sitting out in this last period.
Well, a probably quite wise thing to do with looking up at playing against Latvia, who was playing really well today, and Sweden in the next two coming days, so to give everybody a fair share of playing time.
It also will be interesting to see how the level of the play for all teams develop, as most teams arrive kind of Tuesday to Wednesday, so it's basically day three when they're here. Usually you say jet lag is the worst on day three, so probably the speed and the intensity only will increase over the next few days.
Yeah, and getting used to the floor and getting used to the environment here is of course also. And the question is of how much have they played during the last 2-3 months. So it's a different thing of practicing, but how many games have they played?
Good shot by Jan Seiler. Did spot that gap very well. For once, no chance to save the ball for Jasta Fong. And it's also good to see he is back in the net. Just too many players in front of him. Got screened. And Switzerland with the first goal in this last period. Possession. For Team Thailand, not for long.
Maybe the two goals scored by Thailand in the second period. Now a little bit too much hoping for solutions instead of building them. And then they get...
Or maybe not, third goal.
Yeah. Well,
I think assist was more or less a Swiss player. I think it was Jan Burki.
Yeah, you can clearly see him reacting quite quickly to the fact that wasn't maybe the planned thing to do.
And very well executed by Jerry Oat.
Yep.
He wasn't too much surprised to suddenly get the ball there from the opponent.
No.
We've seen before when you get the ball, you go, oh, what shall I do with this ball now? But well done.
Yeah.
7-3 was a very quick answer from Thailand to that seventh goal from Switzerland. Let's see if Switzerland will be able to increase the ball speed again, or if they will cruise to the end of this game.
Now Switzerland has brought the right side forward quite deep when they are attacking, and which is makes it difficult because it should be the forechecking player's player, but now it becomes the defenders, and the defenders suddenly has a 2-1 situation which is difficult to handle.
Graf to Hello. Salo coming in again. Behind the goal, Paolo Ridi with the ball. Got blocked. This was another attempt by number 39, Yeriot, to set up another chance. At the moment, both teams not holding back, trying to create quick chances after ball possession.
And now we have moved into the running game phase.
Yeah, Switzerland probably would like to see another 2-3 goals on the scoreboard. Thailand pretty happy, getting keen to score a fourth. But it is Manuel Maurer who puts the 8th goal in the net. That center spot area in front of the goalie is still an issue for Team Thailand.
Yeah, and especially now there was in principle a 4-against-1 situation. But still taking the player from the side, not the blade.
Yeah. Basically, when you think afterwards as a defender, you were there, but you were not really there. You were physically there, but not present.
You were not. I mean, it's the blade which is the important part of the stick in this situation. And I mean, if you take players like Kim Nielsen or other big stars, then it doesn't make a difference how close you are, and even if you would be hanging on their neck, if the blade is free and they can even play it with one hand. So that's again the learning curve. Why is it important to block the blade?
Part of the development process for Team Thailand, which is handling this game very well. Seiler. This time, blade was covered by Rinne Falk. Breyer. Heller. Straight to breakaway. For a quick moment, there was this chance.
Very, very good play back the ball.
Yeah, seen too much risk.
Yeah.
Keeping ball possession. Strong performance from Jan Vuki gaining that ball. Pretty fast. Santipong overtaking Bischofberger. Thailand setting up a free hit. Moving the ball around. Santipong again. Now Switzerland with the breakaway, Jan Seiler. Well intercepted by Ferrafong. Switzerland once more in control of the ball. Trying to set up. Strong 1-1 from both parties, with the better end for Jan Zauk from the Swiss team. Simon with a breakaway. Lante Fong. Thailand learning quickly and controlling the ball, possess the ball. Now we're pushing up. Paul already almost on the near post. And again, Tobias Heller setting it up for the Swiss team. On point position, Luca Graf, Breyer coming in. Now, center area, bit more crowded, makes it way more difficult for the Swiss plan. Distant shot from Luca Graf.
And great save by the Thai goalie. And again, they're really trying to play in front of the goal, trying to detect them. And flicking the ball from there.
Well, we just got visited by the two mascots from the World Games. Power break, World Games is also very often discussed. Is this the only way floorball has a chance to go about the Olympics? Still everywhere people are talking, has floorball ever a chance Olympics? You, as the Secretary General from the IFF, what is the latest on floorball and being at the Olympic Games?
Well, I would say that in the next forthcoming 20 years, it's most unlikely if it's not organized in Stockholm, Helsinki, Zurich or Prague, because it's the home, it's the organizer who chooses the additional sports and promotes them. I would say that more importantly is to grow the sport and make it bigger, both in number of players and also in visibility and awareness. And media is extremely important here.
So it will be important to have the growing the whole, let's say, the whole environment of floorball.
Yeah,
worldwide.
Yeah, and then also getting more countries to compete for the medals.
That means still some years to go then.
Yep.
And here we have only about 6 minutes to go, where Manuel Maurer with another big chance, but it was Patrick Mendelin from Basel who puts the ball into the net. Goal number 9 for the Swiss team.
There is a slight risk now that the steam of the Thai is soon ending. They are not that active anymore in defending, and the unforced error causes then situations like this. And it would be important to try to still play the last 6 minutes of the game.
As we have discussed before, also the physical perspective is of course part from the learning curve, from the experience. It's probably the Swiss players, they train all daily, at least some of them probably twice a day.
Yep.
Which is the common standard within the top four nations. But is there a league which are professionals in the world?
Only a few. Like not too many, so it's there are a lot of semi-professional players who maybe work half a day or something, and then to make it possible to train and there are of course some maybe 30, 35, 40 in the world who are only playing, so to say, and gets paid for it.
Means majority also in the top nations are still working, maybe not all full time, but at least part time. And Thailand is working really hard here in this game to defend the Swiss off away from their own goal. Switzerland is going for goal number 10. Swiss tradition usually is the person who scores goal number 10 has to bring something to training, to event, if it's some drinks, a cake, or whatever it is. Sometimes there are rumors that not everyone wants to score their goal number 10.
Okay.
Jan Sauk.
Well, here in Birmingham, the cake would be big, so.
Yes. Rookie Mendelin with a shot. Not a save by Yotsa Fong. Buki. Mendelin gaining ball back with the ball for Jan Sauk. Well defended by the whole defense structure from Thailand.
Mauer wasn't happy about about that solution. He would have wanted the ball.
Yep. This is probably part of the Swiss internal line learning curve.
Yes.
Who is doing what and when and how? Switzerland winning the ball back. With Breyer and Luka Graf setting up again that back line.
Now even the Swiss men's and women's fistball teams are wanting the 10th goal.
Yes, they're cheering along. Is it Tobias Heller? No, it isn't. So again, Yotsa Fong with a save. He must be now over 33 saves, which is a high number.
Yeah.
And now Santi Pong with the ball. Chusak. Well spotted by Hello. Not a save. And Jan Sauk.
Well, you said earlier that he's really skillful with the stick, and that was a clear example of that.
Timeout, Team Thailand. In floorball, in case you're new to the sport, you can call for one timeout over the whole game. It's not per period like in other sports. It's one timeout, 30 seconds over the whole game. And you only can call it during a break of the game.
Yeah.
Here we see another replay on the go. Some quick passing. As Thailand has called their timeout, let's see. They have some tricks up their sleeve for this last 2 minutes. Everything ready. Quick play. Well blocked. Silent Breyer. Hello. And silent. Really moving the ball forward. Back to Graf. And now Thailand. Almost with another chance for a breakaway. Hello, Siler. Shot into the block. All the experience from Luka Graf to defend this ball.
Yeah, the importance, he didn't try to win it, he just tried to play it 0-0 to see to it that Thailand wouldn't be able to attack from there.
This time intercepted from the Thai player. A last minute, it's going pretty wild. Go from left to right, right to left. Now Jan Sauk. Slowing it down. Jan Buki with a far distance shot. Another one. Simon lost the ball. Goal by Patrick Mendelin. He was going for that goal number 10. Tried with a few shots before. Yeah. Here it is. Nice trick. Lifting the ball over the stick from the opponent, running into. And one touch. Out of the air, volley, goal.
You could say it looked like the Thai defender thought that was unfair.
Yeah, maybe Thailand has coming in. And just 8 seconds before the end of the game, Switzerland was able to score that goal number 10. It is the end of the game. 10-3 for Switzerland. How would you summarize this game?
I think we have two quite content teams on the field. Switzerland was able to probably do the things they wanted to do, and Thailand survived really well, and thinking about that after 4-0, still being able to level the score a bit and played quite really well in the second period, but also being able to try and even tried then to do a few more advantageous risks in the end. So pretty much, I would say, both teams pretty happy.
And this obviously also was the very first time an Asian team was showing off at the World Games in floorball. And yeah, as it is the World Games, so obviously it's very great to have teams from all over the world. Now we're waiting for the best player prizes. Any guesses?
Well, I think that the Thai goalkeeper should be pretty clear.
And for Switzerland?
Well, maybe Mendelin?
Could be.
The other option would have been Conrad. He played really well, two first periods.
For Thailand, it is number 72, Yot Savong, and it is Patrick Mendelin for the Swiss team. Thank you for watching this third game of the day. There's another game coming up very soon between Czech Republic and USA. And of course, we're here the next 4 days for you. Thank you very much. Have a great time.